Good morning and welcome to worship in Oxnard Chapel. Well, we have made it this far. And the end is in sight. And new beginnings.
Yes.
New beginnings. So today, we gather to share in worship that is led and designed by three of our graduating seniors. Chase Green, Drew Colby, and Pat Furtado. These are the three awards, the only three awards that people know who's receiving them beforehand, because as Drew said to me politely yesterday, this is a funny award. You get it and you have to work. That things you love to do. So we are blessed by their gifts as they lead us today. I want to remind you that we continue to worship through a week from, actually through to the cathedral at graduation, but that's another story. We will continue to worship here in Oxnard Chapel through a week from Thursday. Tonight, William Lee will be leading the ABS service, the last one of the year for them. He is their outgoing president, and he will be preaching. Tomorrow, Mike Jira is going to be preaching as we have a service that helps us set our eyes from this place towards what is beyond here and the places we are going. Next week, there will be two briefer services on Tuesday and Wednesday at the designated times. And then Thursday at 4:30, we will gather for the graduate Eucharist. Everyone is invited and urged to come. The graduating seniors and their families are our guests, and there's a special part of the service in which they are commissioned. But we hope that the community will also be here at 4:30 on Thursday to share in that special time. There's nothing new about communion except the presence of the Lord that is new every day. By the piano, that cup still will have wine in it, and in front of the pulpit, this cup will have juice in it. We welcome any who are visiting with us today, and let us pause as we feel the Spirit upon us as we worship this day.
Of the Lord, for his name
alone is exalted. His glory is above earth and heaven. He has raised up a horn for his people. Praise for all his faithful, for the people of Israel who are close to him. Praise the Lord.
May God be gracious to us, and bless us, and make his face to shine upon us, that your way may be known upon earth, your saving power among all nations.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity, and guide the nations upon earth.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all
the earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, has blessed us.
May God continue to bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear the Lord.
I invite you to remain standing for our opening hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. A reading from Revelation. And in the Spirit,
He carried me away to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. It has the glory of God and a radiance like a very rare jewel, like jasper, clear as crystal. It has a great high wall with 12 gates, and at the gates, 12 angels. And on the gates are inscribed the names of the 12 tribes of the Israelites. On the east, 3 gates. On the north, 3 gates. On the south, 3 gates. And on the west, 3 gates. And the wall of the city has 12 foundations. And on them are the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. The angel who talks to me had a measuring rod of gold to measure the city and its gates and walls. The city lies 4 square, its length the same as its width. And he measured the city with his rod, 1,500 miles. Its length and width and height are all equal. He also measured its wall, 144 cubits by human measurement, which the angel was using. The wall is built of jasper, while the city is pure gold, clear as glass. The foundations of the wall of the city are adorned with every jewel. The first was jasper, the second sapphire, the third agate, the fourth emerald, the fifth onyx, the sixth carnelian, the seventh chrysolite, and eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, and the tenth chrysoprase, and the 11th jacinth, and the 12th amethyst. And the 12 gates are 12 pearls. Each of the gates is a single pearl. And the streets of the city are pure gold, transparent as glass. I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And this city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God is its light, and its lamp is the Lamb. The nations will walk by this light, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. Its gates will never be shut by day, and there will be no night there. People will bring into it the glory and the honor of the nations, but nothing unclean will enter it, nor anyone who practices abomination or falsehood, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb through the middle of the street of the city. On either side of the river is the tree of life, with its 12 kinds of fruit, producing its fruit each month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. Nothing accursed will be found there anymore, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads, and there will be no more night. They need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. The word of the Lord. Lord.
Jesus answered him, "Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not, but is from the Father who sent me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away, and I am coming to you. If you loved me, you will rejoice that I am going to the Father.
because the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe. This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God.
Our New Testament passage today starts in the 21st chapter of Revelation, and it picks up right where last week's lectionary passage left off. Our guide, John, who could be but probably isn't the Apostle John, has been exiled to the island of Patmos, and through the words he left us, we have the privilege of tuning in vicariously to share what he sees. Bow with me, please, in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for drawing us to this place today, for calling us throughout our lives to be yours. Bless us now that the words spoken here and the words heard here may be your word, and that what we choose to do with them may be your will. In the name of our living Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. So let's go see what John is seeing on that high mountain on the island of Patmos. What a show it is. He's already seen, before we ever get to this passage, he's already seen visions of the Lamb's ultimate victory over death and pain and all sorts of sin, every kind of evil, and the coming of a new heaven and a new earth, the passing away of the old and the coming of the new, and a whole new Jerusalem, a new Jerusalem made ready as a bride and adorned for her husband. And today we join him as he is carried off in the spirit by an angel of God to a high mountain. Now, if we haven't learned anything else here, I certainly hope we have all learned that mountaintops are special places in the Bible. They hold both real and figurative significance. Many think of them as thin places, places where the gap between the human and the holy is smaller and more easily reached. On Mount Moriah, Abraham prepared to sacrifice Isaac, and by divine intervention, he instead learned that the Lord provides. On Mount Horeb, Moses spoke with God and received the tablets of the law, and on Sinai, he and the elders of Israel made their everlasting covenant with the living God. On Mount Carmel, Elijah contested with the priests of Baal and showed that his God was the one true, all-powerful God. And later, he too went to where that same God encountered him again, but this time as a still, small voice. Jesus understood the draw of the mountaintop. He often went up the mountain to pray, and in one of our most enduring images of him, he took with him Peter and James and John, and he was transfigured before them, taking on his true form and appearing to them in the full glory of God. There's something else that I hope we've learned about mountaintop experiences. The time we spend on the mountain, the things we see there, the things we hear there, the things we do there, those all serve a very real purpose for us, as for Abraham and Moses, for Elijah, for Jesus, and for Peter, James, and John. The time we spend on the mountain prepares us for the work we have before us in the valley. This day, in this passage, John is carried in the spirit, and he's told he's going to see the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And what in fact he does see is the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. Now, the biblical record on cities is by no means as clear as that of mountains. Cities have at best a mixed and more often a bad reputation. Biblical cities are portrayed as places where humans seek in vain to build their own safety in the form of high walls and closed guarded gates rather than trusting in the providence of God. Cities are artifacts of human making that suffer by comparison when viewed over and against the goodness of God's creation. Jerusalem was great, but twice it was destroyed by enemies. The walls built to protect it did not suffice. And as for other cities, Lehi even mentioned Sodom, Gomorrah, Babylon, or Babel, the original gated community. I can tell everyone who had Denise for And what about the world today? What does the word city conjure up for us? Depending on where you live, you may regard cities as centers of community and fellowship, of culture and civilization, or you might view them as merely dens of iniquity, places of crime and poverty, overcrowding and desperation. Regardless, cities are with us, and we with them. They are a fact of our lives, and for most of us, they are the places we will minister with and to God's people. Because today, for the first time in human history, actually since 2008, more than one half of the world's population are city dwellers. The city of today is the reality we face today. But the city John tells us about, this new Jerusalem coming down out of heaven, this isn't like that. This city is a perfect place, crafted by God's own hand. This is a new Jerusalem for a new earth. For as we know by this point in the message, victory has been won. It's a done deal, and God has made all things new. In this city, there is no crime, there's no strife, no poverty, no overcrowding, and no desperation. In fact, there isn't even a hint of darkness, for the glory of God shines throughout this city. The streets are paved with gold, and the gates are even pearly. Precious stones abound, and everything about it symbolizes the wholeness and the goodness of God. The walls and foundations of this city are well formed and solid, fortified, so that they will never crumble like earthly cities crumble. In the center of the city is a pristine river, as clear as crystal. On the river banks grow the tree of life, bearing a dozen varieties of fruit and producing a fresh crop every month. And as if that isn't enough, the trees have leaves that are therapeutic. They can heal nations. And if they can heal nations, they can heal people and they can heal relationships. Can you imagine it? And unlike all those cities that were part of the old earth, closed up, isolated, and fearful, this city's gates are always thrown wide open. All are welcome. This city is, in short, the fulfillment of everything God has planned for us, the communion of the faithful, the end for which we were all created. The inhabitants of the people of God, now at last seeing, knowing, serving, worshiping their Lord face to face. And a few minutes from now, when we gather at the Lord's table, we too will join that congregation. But whereas the old Jerusalem was the center of worship specifically because it housed the temple, this new Jerusalem has no need for a temple. It has no need for a structure where a select group of priests go in and out to be in the presence of God, because God and the Lamb are the temple, and they are ever present in this city. This city is the church, the bride of Christ. The people of God are a royal priesthood of believers, now brought to perfection, united with one will, amazingly diverse, and yet utterly free of misunderstanding, the distrust, the envy, the pride, and all those other human failings that today lead us into factionalism and strife and division. Friends, this is the consummation for which we work and the promise by which we live. In many ways, large and small, I have seen glimpses of that ideal city right here. I have seen this community welcome members from nearly every faith tradition and from nations all around the world. Together we have sung and prayed and laughed in dozens of languages. I have seen it in study groups where stronger students reach out to include and dedicate extra time to help those who may be struggling. I have seen it in community members called and dedicated to the single goal of equipping servants for the Lord. And in this I mean everyone, students, faculty, staff members, from the folks who tend the gardens and clean the floors to the dean and the president and every member of the faculty. All united in that one goal of growing servants for the Lord. I have seen it in the common ground we share with seminarians from other schools, in consortium and immersion classes, where lifelong friendships can be forged almost instantly on the basis of one fact, that we're all in this together. I have seen it in the grace extended by professors whose foremost desire is for all who are called by God to succeed in their studies here and fulfill that call. I have seen it in thousands of All Saints Day luminarias on our hillside, commemorating for all in the city to see the sacrifice of too many of God's children. I suspect I am neither the first nor the last to think of this journey through seminary as mountaintop time. Like Peter so long ago, I find it tempting to stay just a while longer. It's been 7 years, I think it's more. Perhaps pitch a tent, or as one of my colleagues in a preaching class said, this would be a great spot to build a Christian retreat center. But time on the mountain is intended to prepare us for the work to be done in the valley. We know that the churches we go out to serve today are far from the perfection God intended for the body of Christ. We know wherever we are called that the cities in which we are served are not yet anything like that perfect New Jerusalem. We have our work, God's work, cut out for us. It will not be easy, for it never is. But we will not be alone, for we never are. We need not be afraid. We have the peace of Christ and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. We have tasted the fresh air of the mountaintop. We have been privileged to stand in the thin places. And that privilege bears with it an obligation. So today we must ask ourselves, today and every day from this point on, what am I doing right now to help bridge that gap between the human and the holy? How am I working to help grow and equip worthy servants for the Lord? What is God calling me to do next? And where? And with whom? May God grant each and all of us grace to answer that call. And let the people of God say together, Amen.
Amen.
And as we will soon do that, it is also my honor to tell you that I have prayer requests from the construction crew outside. I don't know who arranged this, I don't know how it happened, but they're here. And so I'm going to read them off. And afterwards, I'm going to invite us to, when I say, Lord, in your mercy, you respond, of course, with, hear our prayers. And then after that, we'll get to the prayers we'd like to worship. For safety, for on-site and travel, many of these workers travel over 100 miles to come to Wesley to work. For children, especially the newborns. For Pops, who is in the hospital with heart issues. For Joy, Amber, Bruni. For broken hearts. For Bolivia. For financial stability. For the local Union 26 and its members. For our country and our elected leaders. For good weather to work in. For marital concerns. For an older brother who is a pastor for his ministry. For family siblings with addictions. For girlfriend issues. Study work when this contract is up. For parents, for Scarlett, for Nicole, for Ashley, for Bridget, for Milton, who lost his brother in an accident unexpectedly, for health issues, for Russell and Eva, for an upcoming wedding, the ability to send children to college, military friends overseas, for Jenna, for the people of West Virginia, and for Sharon. Lord, in your mercy. How amazing is it that we have a community right next to us that is a part of this place now? May we go in turn and seek to give them comfort when we can. Let us continue our prayers, and I ask you to lift up the prayer concerns that are close to your heart. After each one, we'll all respond, Lord, hear our prayer. What are those this morning? For people in transition, Lord, in your mercy. For the people of Nigeria and Ande Emmanuel, Lord, in your mercy. For Lindsay, Lord, in your mercy.
For Judy, who at this very moment is going through cancer surgery.
For Judy, at this very moment, who is going through cancer surgery, Lord, in your mercy. For Dr. Mitchell, who lost her mother,
Bobby,
Lord, in your mercy.
universe and caregivers who are dealing with Alzheimer's. Lord, in your mercy. For families who are traveling to graduation, Lord, in your mercy. Rob, Mike, Lord, in your mercy. For Rita Martin, Lord, in your mercy. For Aaron and Marlene, Lord, in your mercy. Jonas Alessine, Lord, in your mercy. For Lanier and Henry, Lord, in your mercy. I invite you, as we continue our prayers, bow our heads before God. Almighty God, we are standing on holy ground, built upon the foundation of prayer, worship of you, reading of Scripture. How blessed we are, abundantly blessed, to be in community, to be in this space where we can worship freely the God who has done so much for our lives. Thank you for the love and grace that you work within us, bringing us together, holding us strong and steadfast, even in the midst of finals and exams and grading. Many of us are in the midst of great transition. We ask for peace and patience within our souls, that you would walk each and every day with this entire Wesley community and all the people that are associated with it. We especially this morning lift up to you, instruction workers who have poured out to your hearts these prayers. May they be blessed. May you wrap your warm, embracing arms around them. Holy God, so much we are thankful for. Work within us your love and the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now may we all sing together and hear you.